apologies for the automatic Zoom message. I think that's a new feature on Zoom. And I'm now going to switch my camera off and invite Helen to start her talk. So thank you, Helen.
Thanks very much, Kathy. And yeah, it's really lovely to see everybody here today. Thanks so much for supporting us again. So I'll stop my video and make a start. So as Kathy mentioned, in celebration of the Open Garden Squares event, this month's talk will highlight the varied and beautiful gardens of William Morris's homes. And we'll be looking at them through contemporary photographs, letters, Morris's own words, and also by looking at some of the beautiful designs we have in our collection that reflect Morris's gardening ideas. So we'll begin by looking at descriptions of Morris's childhood gardens before exploring the inspiration behind the innovative planting schemes at Red House, before moving on to Morris's particular approach to design in his lectures and how this was reflected in his last two homes, Kelmscott Manor in Oxfordshire and Kelmscott House in Hammersmith. Morris's birthplace, Elm House in Walthamstow, was sadly destroyed, and we therefore know very little of the garden. However, J.W. McHale, Morris's biographer, tells us that the house had a large lawn surrounded by shrubberies and kitchen gardens, with a large mulberry tree. When Morris was 6 years old, the family moved to Woodford Hall, which was situated in a 50-acre park on the edge of Epping Forest, with the River Lea just 3 miles away. Morris would later create this design, Lea, inspired by his childhood memories of that river. And it's one of a series of patterns he named after tributaries of the Thames. Morris recalled his second home affectionately, writing, "To this day, when I smell a may tree, I think of going to bed there by daylight." He recalled that he and his brothers and sisters had their own gardens. And as a little boy, he loved the hepatica and herb patch by the kitchen garden. After the death of Morris's father, the Morris family moved to Waterhouse, Walthamstow in 1848. The building is now the William Morris Gallery, situated in Lloyd Park. But in Morris's day, it had a large lawn leading to a moat 45 feet wide in which Morris and his brothers fished. The moat had an island with aspens, holly, chestnut and hawthorn trees. It was whilst living in Walthamstow that Morris's love of nature originated, particularly with the nearby Epping Forest, saying, "When I was a boy and young man, I knew it yard by yard." Morris later lamented the destruction of trees in Epping Forest, and later said that trees in a garden were vital. While at Oxford between 1853 and 1855, Morris studied at the Bodleian, which was important for his developing ideas with its collection of illuminated manuscripts detailing medieval gardens, which would be put into practice in Morris's next home. Red House, Morris's first married home in Bexley Heath, Kent, is of great importance to learning of Morris's inspiration when it comes to garden design. The house was built especially for Morris by Philip Webb within an orchard. The building of Red House needed hardly any disturbance to the trees. Webb himself lists 80 trees on the site, the majority of which were fruit trees, including apples, pears, cherries, plums and damson. We even know some of the old varieties of trees present in the orchard. Morris had long been inspired by the medieval garden, and as we'd learned, he studied illuminated manuscripts in literature, such as the work of Geoffrey Chaucer, and also in religious paintings. Walled and enclosed gardens were particularly favourite features of medieval gardens, and Morris admired the practicality of them, with their sensible combination of fruit trees, vegetables, herbs and flowers. Morris and his new bride Jane moved into their home in 1860. It was where Jenny and May, their two daughters, were born, and the young family were to spend 5 happy years at the only house they were to own. All the rest were rented, as was common at the time. The garden was planned from the start to be integral to the home. Webb's original plans for the house show that roses, including moss roses, white jasmine, bergamot, Aaron's rod, and passion flowers were to be planted against the north and west walls. At just over an acre, the garden was a major feature of the house, and McHale, Morris's biographer, describes it here. The garden was planned with the same care and originality as the house, but in Morris's knowledge of gardening, he did, and did with reason, pride himself. But of flowers and vegetables and fruit trees, he knew all the ways and capabilities. Red House Garden, with its long grass walks, its midsummer lilies and autumn sunflowers, its wattled rose trellises enclosing richly flowered square garden plots, was then as unique as the house it surrounded. The building had been planned with such care that hardly a tree had to be cut down. Apples fell in at the windows as they stood open on hot autumn nights. There are no images of the original garden layout, but detailed contemporary descriptions bring it to life. There are also clues to the nature of the garden from the interior decoration of the house, particularly the painted settle in the entrance hall, which includes portraits of Morris and his circle situated in a medieval style enclosed garden. May Morris, his daughter, recalled scented borders which had rosemary and lavender planted. And Georgiana Burne-Jones, wife of his great friend Edward Burne-Jones and a frequent visitor to Red House, tells us, many flowering creepers had been planted against the walls of the house from the earliest possible time, so that there was no look of raw newness about it. And the garden, beautified beforehand by the apple trees, quickly took shape. In front of the house, the garden was spaced formally into 4 little square gardens, making a big square together. And each of the smaller squares had a wattled fence around it with an opening by which one entered, and all the fence roses grew thickly. Where we sat and talked or looked out into the well court, 2 sides were formed by the house and the other 2 by a tall rose trellis. Trellis wallpaper of 1862 was one of Morris's first wallpaper designs, inspired by the rose trellises at Red House, with the birds appropriately designed by Webb, the architect of the house. And May Morris recalled that wallpaper on the walls of her childhood nursery. Emma Valance, another of Morris's biographers, noted that the garden divided into squares was hedged by either sweetbriar or wild rose. He said, each enclosure with its own particular show of flowers, on this side a green alley with a bowling green, on that orchard walks amid gnarled old fruit trees, all struck me as a vividly picturesque and uniquely original scene. The bowling green that Valance mentions was about 75 feet long and 10 feet wide, whereas the square gardens were quite small, measuring around 30 feet square. Interestingly, a new planting scheme is being planned at Red House, which will draw on these sources to reflect Morris's original vision. Morris moved in to the house of his dreams in 1871. And here we have Kelmscott Manor in Oxfordshire. And the garden delighted him as much as the house. Enclosed by high walls and divided by hedges, it conformed to his ideal of a garden fenced from the outside world, and he therefore altered it little. He wrote that the garden had crocuses, aconite, yellow jasmine, scabious, red and white hollyhocks, and cottage annuals such as poppies, china asters, sweet sultans, and dianthus. Also present were roses, including yellow roses in the gable wall of the barn, and May Morris recalled later that the garden was gay with thousands of tulips. We also know that there were strawberries, and the Strawberry Thief block printed cotton of 1883 is one of Morris's most popular repeating designs for textiles. It takes as its subject the thrushes that Morris found stealing the fruit in his kitchen garden. His gardener was about to shoo them away, but Morris said, "No thrush must be harmed," and it gave him this idea for a new beautiful design. Despite the fact that this design was one of the most expensive printed textiles available from Morris & Co., it became a firm favourite with clients and remains a popular design still available to purchase today. The majority of the illustrations in this talk are from the Society's own collection, and the next few images I'll show you are from a photograph album of May Morris showing a visiting group around Kelmscott Manor in the 1920s. And although somewhat faded and taken obviously from an album, they give a fascinating insight into the gardens when May was living there. May Morris mentions the beautiful wild tulip that my father called the Persian tulip, and that he used a great deal in designs, simply runs riot all over the beds. There were also apple and plum trees, a vegetable garden, and a 400-year-old mulberry tree, highlighting Morris's preference for native flowers and plants. Morris described in a February letter, "Snowdrops are everywhere, but mostly double. However, they give one a delightful idea of spring about." He said in his lectures that a snowdrop was a wonder of beauty. And he went on to say, "There are a few violets out here and there, and a coloured primrose, and some of the hepatica roots have flowered but show no leaves. But how pretty it looks to see the promise of things pushing up through the clean, unsooty soil. I think we shall have a beautiful garden this year." And here we have an image of Mary Lobb, May Morris's companion, who lived at the manor with her, showing one of the visiting group around. And it looks to me like there were tulips in the garden, like May Morris mentioned about them running riot. And here we have May again showing off her garden to the group. Michael, Morris's biographer, wrote, "It is doubtful whether Morris was ever seen with a spade in his hands. In later years at Kelmscott, his manual work in the garden was almost limited to clipping his yew hedges. One of these clipped hedges was known as Fafnir, named after the dragon in Morris's Icelandic saga, Sigurd the Volsung. On another occasion, Morris noticed that his gardener had trellised up the raspberry canes neatly so that they looked like a medieval garden. In his 1880 lecture, Making the Best of It, Morris wrote, "As to colour in gardens, flowers in masses are mighty strong colour, and if not used with a great deal of caution, are very destructive to pleasure in gardening. On the whole, I think the best and safest plan is to mix up your flowers and rather eschew great masses of colour." And this is a delightful photograph of May looking out of her window into a beautiful garden. Just a year before he died, Morris commented that the garden at Kelmscott Manor looked like part of the house, which he had always felt should be the aim of a garden, writing, "Many a good house, both old and new, is marred by the vulgarity and stupidity of its garden, so that one is tormented by having to abstract in one's mind the good building from the nightmare of horticulture which surrounds it." Morris approved of natural flowers and frequently referred to his love of medieval gardens, which had partitions like exterior rooms, as we saw at Red House. He believed that all arts and crafts gardeners should take up the idea that the garden should be in keeping and a reflection of the house, and vernacular architecture should be used as part of the arts and crafts garden. Flowers were naturalised in the Kelmscott garden and were bordered neatly with medieval-like low hedges. Morris hated the fashion for carpet bedding with its strong massing of single bright colours, which he called an aberration of the human mind. Instead, he advocated delicate combinations of scented meadow flowers and the use of local plants. The last time Morris saw his beloved Kelmscott was 5 months before his death in 1896. He wrote to Georgiana Burne-Jones of the garden, "I have enjoyed the garden very much and should never be bored by walking about and in it." Here we have the Society's copy of News from Nowhere, showing the frontispiece, which illustrates the entrance into the manor, the flagged footpath flanked by rose trees, just as it appears today. And bringing us up to the present time, the three gardens at the rear of the house were recently replanted to reflect Morris's scheme and the flowers that feature in his designs. October 1872 saw the Morrises move to Horrington House in Turnham Green near Hammersmith. The house has long since been demolished and little is known of it, and we have no images. So this is an image of Kelmscott House in Hammersmith, the house that we're to move to next. The only description we have of the garden at Horrington House is from Morris, who said it was a very little house with a pretty garden. After 6 years living there, the family saw the need to move and their interest turned here to Kelmscott House in Hammersmith. Morris wrote to Jane, who was on holiday in Italy at the time of his house hunting, about their potential new home. And the garden was a strong feature he put to her in his case for buying Kelmscott House. He said, "The garden is very long and good. It also has a drawback of being overlooked badly down one half of it because the wall lowers there. But we might stick up a great high trellis, which would effectively shut out the onlookers. On the other side, there are gardens and all is quite pretty." Morris tried to allay Jane's reservations about moving here, brought about by Rossetti, by writing, "The garden is really most beautiful. There is a real greenhouse down the garden, if you care for that, and capital stabling and coach house. The situation is certainly the prettiest in London." A few days later, he wrote again, as Jane was still not convinced. "There is a good garden and root house. Besides the large greenhouse, a tank in the former for watering purposes. There are two arbours. There are of big trees, first a walnut by the stable, second a very fine tulip tree halfway down the lawn, said to be the biggest but one in England. Third, two horse chestnuts at the end of the lawn. Beyond that, there is a sort of orchard with many good fruit trees in it, with a rough grass gravel walk all around the garden. And then comes the greenhouse, and beyond that, a kitchen garden with lots of raspberries. Other fruit and vegetables we know were here, including mulberries, plums, quinces, peas, cherries, and pears. The flowers that Morris wrote about in his letters included daffodils, wallflowers, crocus, peonies, Japanese anemones, China asters, hyacinths, sweet williams, roses, foxgloves, orange and white lilies, hollyhocks, poppies, and sunflowers. In fact, sunflowers were amongst Morris's favourite plants, appearing in his designs, prose, and lectures. Although he warned against crossbreeding to make showier blooms, writing of the sunflower that it is both interesting and beautiful, with its sharply chiselled yellow florets relieved by the quaintly patterned sad coloured centre, clogged with honey and beset with bees and butterflies. This is the Society's original watercolour design for Morris's sunflower wallpaper. In one of Morris's letters to Jane, he included a little plan of the garden. He wrote that the orchard was rather longer than he had drawn it, and the kitchen garden not quite so long. The walls were covered with fruit trees, apple, pear and plum. And he ended his letter to Jane, "If you could be content to live no nearer London than that, I cannot help thinking that we should do very well there. And certainly the open river and garden at the back are a great advantage." Morris believed that their friends would visit them in Hammersmith, if only for the sake of the garden and river. And Morris ended his letter, "So let us hope we shall all grow younger there, my dear." Jane was finally persuaded, and the family moved into their riverside home in October 1878. And here we can see Jane enjoying her new garden. In his letters to Jane and his daughters, Morris often described the garden when they were apart. He wrote to Jane on another occasion, "I have just come in from the garden, which is looking nice now, the seeds mostly in and the daffodils almost out in blossom. I am very sorry to say, though, the frost killed almost out all the wallflowers. Poor old Matthews is very slow, but I don't like sacking him. Even on selfish grounds, a new system of horticulture will be more than the garden or I can stand." In his lecture, Making the Best of It, Morris wrote, "Before we go inside our house, nay, before we look at it outside, we may consider its garden, chiefly with reference to town gardening, which indeed I, in common, I suppose, with most others who have tried it, have found uphill work enough. However, uphill work or not, the town garden must not be neglected if we are to be in earnest at making the best of it." He goes on to state his dislike for the ugly landscape gardening style in imitation of large gardens, using strong words against designed landscapes, filling town gardens with formal plants. Whereas Morris's plea was for the simplicity of neat fencing and to fill the spaces with flowers that are free and interesting in their growth, leaving nature to do the desired complexity. He wrote to Jenny in April 1882, "The garden to my Cockney eyes is looking pretty well, although I'm disappointed with the daffies. A friend sent us yesterday a lot of peonies, single ones of various kinds, very handsome. They are Chinese flowers and look just like the flowers on their embroideries." In the autumn, he wrote again to Jenny, "The garden here is going the way of all London autumn gardens, but there is still a sort of pale prettiness about it, and there are a good many flowers, in it chiefly Japanese anemones and Cheney oysters." The garden was extensive at nearly an acre long and illustrated Morris's vision that gardens, both private and public, are positive necessities if the citizens are to live reasonable and healthy lives in body and mind. In the 1950s, the A4 cut through Morris's garden, reducing it by around half, but it remains an interesting plot. And those of you who have visited will recognise this. The Society owns part of the garden which contains a delightful walled garden, something which Morris would surely have approved of. In 1881, saw the Morris and Company workshops move to Merton Abbey on the banks of the River Wandle, where printed cottons were laid out on banks filled with buttercups to dry naturally in the sun. Morris advocated the necessity of factory gardens, believing in the importance of pleasant surrounding for employees. He planted straight away poplars around the meadow at Merton Abbey. There was an orchard, vegetable garden with a asparagus and a beautiful flower garden, which contained white hawthorn, marsh marigolds, wallflowers, irises, hollyhocks, sunflowers, and lilac. We also know from Morris's letters that there was an almond tree and daffodils, and he often used to bring bunches of flowers back home to London with him, including his beloved rose. Morris championed the rose, and here we have the Society's rose printed cotton of 1883. In his lectures, Morris wrote of the exquisite subtlety of form, delicacy of texture, and sweetness of colour, which blend with the richness which the true garden rose shares with many other flowers, yet makes it the queen of them all, the flower of flowers. Morris died at Kelmscott House on the 3rd of October 1896. His bedroom was to the right of the front door on the ground floor of the house, with a view onto the garden at the front of his riverside home. And this beautiful image by the artist David Gentleman perfectly illustrates Morris's views of the garden. It should look both orderly and rich. It should be well fenced from the outside world. It should by no means imitate either the willfulness or the wildness of nature, but should look like a thing never to be seen except near a house. It should, in fact, look like a part of the house. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Helen. That was just wonderful. I mean, there is so much to say about Morris and gardens, isn't there?
Well, there is. I mean, this could have easily been like a full hour long lecture, so I had to cut it down a bit. But hopefully I've sort of covered the main houses and sort of his main views on planting schemes and designing gardens.
Exactly. I mean, I think it's fascinating to hear Morris's views about gardening. And I think he was perhaps ahead of his time, and the sort of that focus on the natural look of gardens and not having those kind of great masses of colour and so on. I think he would be, perhaps in tune with contemporary garden design today. Anyway.
Yes, I imagine, and I know a lot of people have been inspired by him, not only in his own day, but still continuing to times now, definitely.
Yes, yes. Well, let's open up for questions. So if anybody has questions, please do type them into the chat or raise your hand. There's a question here from Elizabeth who says, why did they move so often?
Well, earlier on in Morris's childhood, I think it was more necessity. When Morris's father died, they needed to move to a smaller house. So that was the reason for moving in Walthamstow. They moved to, you wouldn't guess that William Morris Gallery was a small house, but it was smaller than their previous hall that they lived in. So that was more sort of downsizing when their father passed away. And then when Morris's first married home, Red House, which he moved to in 1860, he was intending to live there longer, but in the end, he was only there for 5 years. He intended Burne Jones and his young family to move into Red House with him, and they were almost going to start like a commune of artists and run the company from there. Because when he moved to Red House, the company hadn't been started. It was only started in 1861 when the idea came to him. He found the commuting to London quite onerous. Bexley Heath in Kent was quite a journey for him. He had a horse and carriage to take him to the station, a train journey, and it was quite difficult to actually do that, especially when his two young daughters were born. So he had two babies, May and Jenny, at Red House. He was commuting a long journey into London to run Morris and Company, which he just founded, and he found it just too difficult. And he wrote that he was heartbroken at having to leave Red House, and he never actually returned. He couldn't face to go back to his beloved Red House. So that was the reason he was only there for 5 years, necessity for work. So he moved to London, and then he was sort of living above the shop for a little while. Horrington House in Turnham Green, as I mentioned, we don't have any images of that and know very little about it. It was destroyed many, many years ago. But that was, Jane and Morris both said it was a very small house. Jane, in fact, said it was big enough for one person, certainly not for a family. So after 6 years of living there, they needed to find somewhere else. And they lived at the other two houses they lived at, the last two houses I mentioned, the two Kelmscotts, they were longer. So 1871, Kelmscott Manor, and then 1878, Kelmscott House, and they were both alongside each other. So Morris continued to live at the two Kelmscotts, the London base in Hammersmith, and then more a country residence in the summer, Kelmscott Manor, until he died. So yeah, so various reasons for the length of the houses, apart from the last two, which he was at longer.
Yes. There's quite a few questions coming in. Lots of people saying thank you and how much they've enjoyed the talk, which was brilliant. Let me just go back. Okay, a question about another residence, which is Queen's Square. Were there any gardens there?
I haven't actually found any evidence of that. So it's not to say that there weren't any, but I haven't managed to track anything down. I'm intending to do more research on this because I sort of opened my eyes a bit looking into this more in depth about how fascinating the whole subject is. So I am intending on looking at this in a bit more detail. I really concentrated on the houses that we know more about, but I'm certainly going to look into that. If I do find anything out, I can certainly let people know.
Well, there's a lovely comment here from Kedron who says, a lovely talk, thank you. Please write a book on the subject.
Oh, that's really kind. Thank you so much. It's so lovely to get these comments. Really, thank you very much.
There's your next project. Chris asks, do we know whether Morris met Gertrude Jekyll?
He did, yes, because I didn't go into, there was not enough time in a short talk, but he did meet her, and she was very much inspired by him. And then she obviously went on to be a very famous and successful gardener, working with architects. So yes, she definitely did meet Morris. I know that for certain, yeah.
And actually, I'm just sort of scrolling down the questions, and I've seen another comment from Chris here, so thank you for that, who says that Queen's Square had the gardens in the centre of the square to which the Morrises had access, and Morris was on the committee for a while.
Oh, that's really interesting. Thanks, Chris. That's great to hear.
Another question, Mitsuki asks, could you explain more about the meaning of the idea that his garden was part of the house?
Yes, well, he felt that it was important for them to be sort of felt as being together, which was why Red House was the only house he ever owned, because it was built especially for him by his great friend Philip Webb. So we see the plants actually on his drawings for Red House. So we know how important it was from the very beginning of building Red House, that the plants and flowers were incorporated the original plans, but he felt that for all of his houses, and he thought that gardens should be used also for a place of relaxation, and it should be integral, and that's another reason why he at Red House in particular, he had those he had rose trellises put up, which were meant to look like exterior rooms, so you could go from the inside of the house to the outside and have those sort of spaces like you would have in an interior. I don't know if that's explained it sort of well enough, but he said that several times in his lecture, Making the Best of It from 1880. He mentions that a garden should be part of the home, not regarded as two separate entities, but sort of a seamless sort of route between one and the other, which is why they should look similar, like the medieval garden style of the enclosed gardens, like exterior rooms.
Mm-hmm. Again, I think that's quite sort of in tune with contemporary garden design today. You know, I know when I've kind of watched things like the Chelsea Garden Show, that's often an idea that comes across, this sort of garden rooms and the bringing the inside outside and vice versa.
Yes, yeah, definitely. Who strongly felt that garden should be a place for relaxing, like that, like the house itself, and they should be enjoyed, and you should get great pleasure from being in the garden.
Lots more people saying thank you and how much they've enjoyed the talk. A question about the name of Kelmscott House. Was it named Kelmscott House before Maurice moved there?
No, before he moved in, it was called The Retreat. And the reason that Maurice changed it, well, there were a couple of reasons. He felt that at the time, in Victorian times, a retreat was often another name for an asylum. So Maurice, he actually wrote to Jane, people will think the authorities are trying to reclaim me, he said to his wife. And so he straight away changed the name, The Retreat, and he changed it to Kelmscott House to link it by name to Kelmscott Manor, which he'd been renting since 1871, so several years previously. And the reason for that is he loved the fact that both Kelmscotts were actually on the Thames, although many miles apart. Kelmscott House is in Hammersmith, Kelmscott Manor is in Oxfordshire. And to celebrate that, he actually did two boat journeys in a little boat called the Ark. He rowed with the help of lots of friends, and it took about a week to do it. He rowed all the way from Kelmscott House to Kelmscott Manor and had great fun along the way. The name Kelmscott actually originated with Kelmscott Manor, because it's in the village of Kelmscott, and then he named Kelmscott House after that.
Two questions here from Stan. The first one is, he says he's interested in his ideas about the importance of factory gardens, and notes that Joseph Rowntree did something similar in his chocolate factory in York. And then he also asks, is it possible to see some of his comments about gardens in any particular text?
Yes, Maurice wrote about factory gardens. As with many other aspects, he felt that workers, his employees generally should have a better quality of life. As many of you will know, he hated the factory system, the poor quality of life that the workers had. And he felt that people should have access to gardens. He strongly believed nature was vital. And his comments about gardens, I didn't go into great detail, again, lack of time, but he did say, if I can find it quickly, just to keep people waiting, he believed in the importance of the pleasant surrounding for employees. Actually, I think there's a quote in, I haven't got a quote to hand, but I think there's a quotation in his Making the Best of It lecture. I can look that out, and I could certainly send that to you.
That's great, thank you. I think that's all the questions that I can see in the chat, and lots of people saying thank you and how much they've enjoyed the talk.
Thank you.
And a comment here from Duncan, who says it's a really good way to absorb more about different aspects of Maurice with great illustrations and informative presentations.
Oh, thank you. That's really brilliant to read. Thank you so much. I do appreciate these comments. I really do. Thanks.
And just to let people know, in case you didn't know, at the end of the talks, we do put them on YouTube, so you can go to the Society's YouTube channel and you can watch them all again. So if you've missed any of the previous talks, then do have a look at those. More questions coming in. There's a comment from Natalia here, who says, don't forget the garden at the Merton Abbey Mills.
Which was the one I was really referring to. It was Merton Abbey when I mentioned about the sort of, I mean, it wasn't a factory as such, but that was sort of Maurice's alternative. He had beautiful workshops and lovely surroundings for employees at Merton Abbey. And that was where I mentioned some of the beautiful flowers that he had. There was a long list of flowers that I found out at Merton Abbey that he had. And that it must have been absolutely beautiful, the gardens there for the employees. Must have been lovely surroundings to work in. Yeah.
And another really interesting question. How does Morris's stated preference for native plants square with the presence of Japanese anemones and Chinese peonies at Kelmscott House?
I did wonder if somebody might ask that, actually, because he strongly believed in more natural flowers. Although, as you see in some of his designs, he did also incorporate slightly more exotic flowers, whereas May, his daughter, in her design, she tends to be purely like British hedgerows and almost purely native flowers. He does write about sort of more, he did have imported flowers, because I have read that as well, at Kelmscott Manor and at in Hammersmith at Kelmscott House. He does write that. He did write that one of his friends actually sent him some of these. So I don't know whether he felt he had to incorporate them because they were given to him. But I think some of the ones he did obviously must have planted himself. He did have a gardener to help to do a good deal of the work through there, because obviously Morris was doing a huge amount. So we do know that the gardener did plant these as well. So I don't have a perfect answer to this, other than I think some of them were readily available, and there must have been there were beautiful flowers that were incorporated as well. So he did lecture on the value of native plants and flowers, I think, to sort of avoid sort of them being imported so much, and you sort of using, you know, local ones. But I suppose where they were readily available, he did sort of incorporate some himself as well.
Yes. Oh, that's so interesting. Well, thank you. Thank you so much, Helen. And thank you to everybody for joining us today. I think just one thing I wanted to mention before we finish is just another little piece of news, which I'm sure some of you will have be aware of, but our museum at Kelmscott House is reopening this weekend on Saturday. So we're really looking forward to being able to have people coming back and visiting us. And the exhibition, the new exhibition, will be on display, which is about the Kelmscott Press and the Kelmscott Chaucer. So do have a look at our website for more information about visiting us. But just to say again, thank you to everyone for joining us, and thank you very much to Helen. And
thank you. Join us again next
month for the next Coffee with a Curator talk.
Thanks very much for joining us. Good to see everybody. Thank you.
Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye.